All right. Is this your beer? This is your beer. No, that's not me. I finished mine, I believe. Okay. We're live. Right? Framing's okay, Kyle? How are we looking here?
No, that is you.
You're good.
Yep, that one's rolling, right? We're rolling. All right. We're live. Welcome to another episode of Between Two Turns. I'm your host, or one of your hosts, for now, Justin Reynolds.
Along with Randy Spizer.
Randy Spizer. together we're just a couple of kooks.
Yeah,
between two kooks. our main producer, Kyle Meza from Bear Flag Fish Company, is here behind the camera, multiple cameras.
I hear two.
Tristan Meza over here. Is that rolling?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
I can double check, but I think so.
Does that look like it's filming, Tristan? All right, cool. So, I bet you that's Jack.
Eggs are done.
That's gotta be, oh, that wasn't the doorbell?
No.
Okay. Eggs are done. Wait, you hear that ticking?
Yeah, it's my timer, the thing though.
So is it a time bomb?
Yeah, it sounds like it, I'll fix that.
All right, so tonight, let's start out.
Do we have any just said, yeah, boys.
Who was that?
Nasta.
Hey, what's happening? Scott Hewlett. Hewlett number two, yeah. Two T's, I believe. Let's start out tonight by showing these things off. Fred Hall is coming up next week, Wednesday, March 1st through Sunday, March 5th, correct? And it looks like we built this set, like we're just a couple of guys that are taking ourselves way too serious and we have a set for our web show, but this is kind of like two birds with one stone. Cool. So, yeah, this is our Fred Hall trade show booth. We're going to be in space 314. So any of you guys can come hang out with us Wednesday through Sunday. Come check us out. And I just kind of want to give some respect to our really good friend Hopper Doggy, Ryan Hopper. He did some really, really beautiful watercolor pieces that will be on display on the outside of our booth, on the starboard side of our booth.
Starboard side.
And... this is for sale, and basically whatever this piece right here sells for, Hopper's donating 100% of that to Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, and we'll get more into that a little bit later. But so he did this calico bass with a surface iron in its mouth being held up by an anonymous angler, and then that looks like a few boilers at the island of your choice. And then being the talented artist and just really incredible philanthropic human being that he is. Cool. He did two turns for us. And these are for the show. And they'll be on set with us every time we do a broadcast. But we just wanted to give a special thank you to... Okay. Awesome. But yeah. So thank you, Hopper. You're an awesome human being. We definitely appreciate this. For now, they're just going to be kind of hanging out with us in here. And that's that. So, I'm going to grab a seat here, Randy.
Yep.
Here. Is that...
Your beer. Are
you sure?
Yeah, mine's right there.
Are you sure?
Yeah, mine's
okay. All right. So, with Fred Hall coming up, we obviously have leaked a little bit of visuals regarding Ritual.
Yes.
New collaboration that yes. We're doing. Got any questions?
Well, I would like to know, I mean, I know, but I think other people would like to know, like, your reasoning behind, you know, doing this this little tribute to calico bass fishermen. Like, why is it so special to you? Why do you, like, love calico fishing so much that you deem to make products with calicos on it and stuff?
Oh, I know you know the answer to this. And most everyone that's probably watching, or for those that aren't watching, which is probably the majority of the United States and the planet Earth. But calico bass are highly aggressive predators.
Yeah.
And they knock the shit out of artificial lures that get put right in front of their faces.
Yeah.
You know, they are just a fucking angry, angry fish. And if they got any bigger than they do now, you wouldn't be able to safely swim anywhere. you'd lose appendages for sure. for those of us that have things that look like worms, you know, we wouldn't be safe. So, I love calico bass. And anyways, our whole show here and our whole kind of like ethos of what fishing is to us is a very soulful approach, being on the water, the adventure aspect of everything. Fishing's the bonus, catching's the icing on the cake. But really, so ritual, and it's just it's an homage to guys like our guest tonight, Jack Sowell. Guys that really paved the path for us to do what we do and really set the standard and kind of just really pioneered the way that we're approaching this fishery. So ritual is an homage to all of you guys, you know, that are just like us, that are devout to the calico bass, you know, the worship of a little checkered fish. And it's for a good cause too. It's not just like, so we're paying our respects to guys that did this before us, and it's not for nothing. And
obviously the money's not to line your pockets. What do you plan to do with the money?
Well, if anybody you know is getting rich from fishing, have them contact me because I want to know their secret. Because that's not why we're doing this. It'd be cool if we could, but you know, we're living filthy rich. That doesn't necessarily mean that we're stacking chips or anything like that, but we're just loaded in the memory bank, swelling, oozing fucking from our ears with memories. So, yeah. Anyways, to go off on that tangent, but the cause here, the money will be the percentage of the proceeds raised with this special limited edition or timeless edition ritual will be donated to the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, which affects my life very personally. I don't speak about it publicly very often because I don't need anyone feeling sorry for me or my family, because we have nothing to be sorry for. Life could always be much worse for everybody out there. I'm sure all of us have seen people struggle. But my daughter, Ohio, she has cystic fibrosis. And so every day of her life for almost the last 11 years, she's been fighting cystic fibrosis. And it's a brutal fight, and it's a tough one. Like I said, we all struggle, but hers is very special. And so, you know, with her situation, it's just kind of given me a higher calling and a bigger purpose in life to spread awareness and try to help affect lives affected by CF. And so this is the least I can do. The fucking very least I can do. If I could just cut my fucking limbs out or my organs, if I could do anything more than just this, I would. But this is the very least that we could do, is help raise some funds, spread awareness, and donate to the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. And the money goes toward... That's Ohio. I love you more, baby. The money that we raise, the money that the cystic fibrosis has, it's not just some like shit show charity, you know. Like there's some out there. I don't wanna go down that road. But basically, they donate, or they spend 100% of their money on research toward a cure. It's not this, that, or the other. It's literally strictly for a cure. And there's a million different mutations of this disease, so that's a very broad spectrum. But that's what it goes toward. And so, blah blah blah. That's what we're doing. Ritual is for all of us, you know. For some of us, it's daily. For some of us, it's weekly. For some people like Kyle and Tristan, it's something that's passed on generation to generation. And then for guys like our guest tonight, Jack Sowell, it's a lifetime ritual. You know, dedicating yourself to the pursuit of this beautiful fish and every aspect of adventure that comes along with that pursuit. That's pretty much the most long-winded explanation you could ever have of ritual. So if you missed this broadcast, sorry, yeah. But that's what it's all about.
Speaking of Sowell, what do you think he is? He's like,
I don't know. So yeah, so tonight's guest, Jack Sowell. A lot of guys that are, you know, that have been around the block or, you know, used to be on certain forums or at fish tournaments know this guy. Yes! He fucking speak of the devil. Yeah. Serendipity is a beautiful thing. Our tonight's guest is here. You made it. Come on in, Jack.
I got to park. I've just double parked out here.
He's got to look. He comes in with a mag light. He's got to park. He's double parked. You want to? Yeah. Yeah.
Have a seat. We're going to
going yeah. live. Do you need this?
We're live right now, Jack.
I don't ever want to see it again.
Yeah.
Come have a seat, Jack. Literally, I was just introducing you or talking about what's going on.
You, are you one that...
So look, this is how fucking crazy the planet's become. That stupid little phone is broadcasting live to like however many people are watching.
Okay.
At home.
Okay.
So we have a live audience and they can comment and ask questions while they're fucking watching and we can try to respond. So
no problem, I'm going home.
So I'll let you like arrive and calm down because it's probably a little stressful getting here. I appreciate
you. I've been up and down this street. I end up we're on the other side of town. You know, I thought, how stupid can anybody get? You know, a stroke will screw your ass all up. I'm looking at my MacBook, I thought, oh, it's upside down. Supposed to be across the street.
But you found us.
Well, I finally parked out here on the numbers, yeah. 215.
Yes, I thought you were close.
There's an alley back there. I'll go look in the alley, and I seen the one next door and then yours, and I figured, I found you.
Well, yeah, you're here. You found us. So... That guy over there, his name's Kyle.
Kyle. I met Kyle somewhere.
You've met him at the tackle shop at Performance.
Oh, okay.
That's Randy's wife, Gabrielle.
Okay.
That's Kyle's son, Tristan.
Okay.
The next generation, little squirt. He's the same age as my daughter. And
that's about the size Benny was.
When you met him?
Yeah.
Right?
No, his boy.
Oh, that's yeah, right. Matt.
Matt was just a little guy.
Yeah. So what I was just, you know, kind of giving an explanation of was... Of what this whole, the premise of this show is basically paying respect and an homage to guys like you. And I know you don't give a shit about the attention and you don't fucking walk around like you're anything special, but there are so many of us.
Well, I am really. I told my wife that several times and she just ignored me.
Right? Well, so yeah, well, I know that about you. And for anybody that's watching that doesn't know much about you, you know, the right people know who you are, but for us, it's...
We're not on right now.
Oh, we're fucking live. There's people in that fucking phone. I promise you right now.
I didn't have any idea. I thought we were just
practicing.
Getting ready.
No, we are. No, but we are. We're just getting ready.
Okay.
Kyle's brought food, so we'll feed you.
I'm fine. I just got to settle down here for a minute.
Yeah, I figured I'll let you settle in. But yeah. So I'll ask you some questions, but I want to give further introduction to you, and that way you can kind of just familiarize yourself. This whole thing right here is our booth for Fred Hall.
Okay.
So it's not just up here fucking every single day of our lives. Like, what the hell is this little thing? So
we got all kinds of stuff here.
Yeah. So we want to create our own little vibe of you know, how we feel about fishing, and share that with people. But so this is kind of like our little set for the show. We're doing this every other week, and like I said, technology's insane. That fucking phone right there is broadcasting live, and people can ask questions and things like that. You know Randy.
When I opened the door and saw Randy, I thought, thank God I'm somewhere. Yeah. I know somebody.
Yeah, you're getting ready for a fist fight at the door.
Yeah.
Who knows who lives here?
Or
so,
you just turned your truck loose on the street and let it go?
Yeah, yeah, it was pretty awesome because Jack's GPS was a Thomas guide and a flashlight, so I liked it.
But how many, you know, before all this other shit,
that's how you had to do
that's
it.
That's how yeah. it was, man.
Yeah.
No, like, no one knows what a fucking Thomas guide is.
Yeah.
Tristan, what's a Thomas guide?
Shit.
I'll take that as I don't know.
Yeah.
It's this book. It was basically the Bible of Los Angeles County, certain counties, right? And it's a map of every single street. And you gotta fucking turn the page. And if you don't find the block on that page, it's probably either on the next page or like three fucking pages away.
Or else that page is gone.
Oh, yeah. Or you lost the page. Yeah.
I lost that page.
Yeah. Or you spilled coffee on it or fucking termite spray.
Yeah.
Or whatever else, right?
Contaminated.
So here's before I go any further into fuck, I'm getting hot, man. You got me fucking worked up, Jack. Let me take that jacket for you too.
No, just throw it down here. It's fine.
Yeah, I think people are asking how much the kid is.
How much the kid is?
Yeah, the kid.
We'll get back to that. We'll get back to that.
So I don't write it down?
$65. And that there's something significant with that. 65 roses is synonymous with cystic fibrosis.
The kit.
So the kit, ritual kit, is $65. And a percentage of those proceeds will go towards the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation.
So you can't buy items individually?
Nope. The jig will be available individually. But there's 90 kits available to the guests at Fred Hall. And then 10 will be available online to out-of-state addresses. Oh,
right.
So we give opportunity for people across the country that want to support the cause.
That's great.
Okay, so back to why we're really here. Today, I call Jack on the phone, and I'm with my daughter, Ohio, and I've got him on speakerphone in the truck. And I say, hey, Jack, it's Justin. And this will be the first time, but not the last time you hear it. Hey, guy. For those that know Jack, like he said, a stroke will fuck you up. And so he just says, hey, guy, because who knows who the fuck. He meets a lot of people, right? So, hey, guy. What's up, Jack? Are you coming tonight to be on this show? Like, yeah, I'll be there. Call my wife, Shirley, give her the address, and she'll make sure I'm there. I said, well, what are you doing? He's at the fucking boatyard. He said, I'm at the boatyard right now, and I'm fighting off the guard dog. And I hear this dog barking in the background. He said, I'm in my boat, and I can't get out. This fucking guard dog got loose.
True story?
Yeah, true story. So,
true story.
So the dog had him trapped. What happened?
There's two dogs.
What'd you do to him?
I didn't do nothing. I was working on my boat. And I went to get out of the boat, and this one comes storming at me, and I jumped back in the boat. And I'm hollering at the old guy who lives next door, and he said, what's the matter? I said, the dogs are out. No, they're not. They're pinned. I said, no, they're not pinned up. They're here. So he came over and got them. And the one is nice. You know, it barks and growls, but you can pet it. But the other one, he'd eat tin can. He'd eat a beer can.
So you got him called off?
I got him called off.
Okay. Well, that's good. What's going on with your boat?
Well, I just had the lower unit done, and I washed it, and
okay.
It's still white underneath there.
Oh, nice. Well, because, yeah, we've been shit on with the weather for the last couple months.
Yeah,
huh?
No, I had the lower unit, new seals put in, and a water pump.
Water pump.
So I'm good for another 1,000 hours.
Yeah, let's, so back to the kit and who Jack is. For those of you guys watching right now that don't have any idea who Jack is, and you can correct me if you want, but I would imagine that you've been fishing calico bass for 30 plus years?
More like 50, 60.
Okay, so how old are you, Jack?
I'm 82.
82 years old, okay? Fishing calico bass more like 50 or 60 years. And what's the name of your boat?
The Rockhopper. Everybody saw it.
Yeah. So Rockhopper. So the jig, and I don't know if you've seen that yet, Jack. I think I told it to you. I told you that, but it's copper with a little bit of red flake. So we named it Rockhopper.
Rockhopper.
Rockhopper. Okay. Not Rockhopper, okay. But it's a tribute. It's a tribute to you.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So, and I know you pretty much only fucking fish swim baits.
I fish jigs.
You fish jigs.
And I've been known to fish bait, but only on long range trips.
Yeah, fishing tuna. Yeah, and we'll get into that because I want to talk about that too. Because a lot of guys who associate you with calico bass don't know you probably have a few cows, right?
Yeah, I got two over three.
That's a lifetime achievement. One of those is a lifetime achievement. So,
I've got a 112-pound wahoo.
That's
and I've
impressive.
Got yellowtail, probably two dozen over 50.
There's not a lot of people on planet Earth that can say anything like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, you know, back to Rockhopper, the boat, you know, how I met Jack and how I first heard of Jack. I was just getting into the advanced calico bass scene, the tournament scene, the guys that were basically just like dedicated strictly to calico bass. My friend, Alex McKeever, who basically handed me the keys to where I am now, which is just right here. I'm not fucking anywhere special, but this is where I am now. He talked about this fucking old timer named Jack Sowell, who was the fucking calico god. And so I heard this fucking name, you know, so much. And so because I respected Alex so much and he had so much respect for you, your reputation preceded you. And so when I finally first started fishing the SWBA, it was the second year they were doing the tournaments. I saw you, and I thought, fuck, there's the fucking guy. You know,
have I shaved or?
Yeah, no. And you know what? That was almost I think it was over 10 years ago, Jack.
Yeah.
So you were still in early 70s. But still fishing tournaments, and whether or not you had a partner, you're backing down the fucking boat by yourself, tying it off. I don't need anybody's help. Don't fucking touch it. Put the boat in water, park the truck, get in the boat, go fish wherever you're going to fish, come and weigh in, and pretty much always be in the money. This guy was either winning or the top three or the top five. He was always cashing the check.
Not that way anymore. I got so young gun.
So that was kind of my introduction to Jack. And he's lived beyond, you know, beyond the reputation that I heard of him. Just a really incredible guy. A fucking cantankerous, rowdy old bastard that has amazing stories and so much to give, and has so many awesome memories, and I'm hoping that we can tap into some of those tonight.
Oh, a lot of people don't realize I fished with Randy Humphrey, who I lost in that boat accident. That was 21 years ago.
Okay.
And that knocked the wheels off me for a while. I slowed down for a long time. And then that was in December, and in February I bought a new boat.
Okay.
And my wife and family come unglued. Like, I wanted to go back out there and jump back in the ocean. I said, no. But I was spooky for a long time after that. And still, I don't take near the chances I used to. And, you know, so many guys have all their stuff underneath the console with 15 bungee cords over it. And the boat flips, and they're in the water, and the boat sinks with all them life jackets, bungee cords right down. Yeah. So now, my life jackets lay in the boat. When we move, you put them on. When we stop, you take them off and throw them anywhere you want to throw them. They're on. You don't have to worry about finding one.
That's a good point. So, I know you've told the story probably fucking 6 million times, but Randy Humphreys.
Randy was just my fishing buddy. I met him at the tackle store, and
what year was that? How long ago are we talking that this friendship started?
Probably 25, 30 years ago.
Okay.
And I fished with Randy for probably 12 years, 10, 12 years, somewhere in that. And he used to call my wife, and he'd say, "Shirley, can Jack go fishing this weekend?"
That's the way.
Yeah. We all live that way. And, you can't pretend.
I'd come home, and Shirley'd say, "Oh, by the way, you're going fishing with Randy tomorrow night." Oh, really? Okay.
Fantastic.
Great. And he was a really neat guy. And then I hooked up with, after that, I fished with Roger for a long time.
Yeah. Roger Eckert from...
Roger Eckert and Benny.
And Benny Florentino.
Benny and Roger and I fished the SWBA, Western Outdoor News tournaments forever.
That's when you guys were taking everybody's money.
We were, and side money too. Everybody wanted to bet side money.
I heard some stories about some sketchy waves trying to get into harbors and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Ventura.
We went to Ventura, and Roger and Benny almost quit fishing on that trip. So did I. I mean, it was bad.
Yeah.
And I kept telling them, "Oh, it isn't bad. Benny, you want to steer the boat, and I'm working the throttle." And I mean, it was, we got in, I thought, "Oh, I'm going to quit fishing. I'm like, Lake Irvine, here I come."
Yeah, so, yeah, Benny told me, fuck, the Coast Guard chopper was flying over you guys on the loudspeaker saying, "Are you guys okay?"
Yeah, they come out in a big boat. We go around circles. The guy talking to me on the radio, "Are you?" And I go, "We're fine. We're fine."
So with Randy, and you said you lost him, and we don't have to go down that road if you don't want to.
No, I'd rather not.
Okay, cool. So that brought us basically up to you and Roger started fishing the SWBA.
Yeah.
And what, for like almost like last 8 or 9?
Yeah, but in between then and when I first started fishing with Roger, I had a stroke on Tuesday. I went to hospital. Friday, I called Roger to pick up my boat. We're going to Ensenada.
So and 3 days later, he's trying
I
to go to Mexico.
I checked myself out of the hospital, went to Ensenada fishing. We were down 30 miles below Ensenada, and I forgot Roger's name. I said, where are we at? What's going on? Roger said, "Oh, Christ." He drove me back to the hotel, brought me home, and 3 days later, some guys brought my boat home that I didn't even know.
And that, yeah, they just, whoever put
they
it together.
They were in the group, and they brought my boat home. And I was down for a couple of weeks, and I snapped right out of it and started fishing again.
Okay, so
it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, shit. I'd say, how long ago was that? When did you have the stroke?
I think 13 years ago.
Okay, so, but now, shit, at 82, I know for the last decade, you've been fishing. You take trips to the islands by yourself. I mean, I've seen you at Catalina 100 times by yourself. I've seen you at Clemente by yourself.
That's almost a thing of the past. I got two daughters that just raised hell with me. I got a wife that raised hell with me. And who'd you go with? I said, I'll drown all by myself. I'm all right.
It's not allowed anymore, huh?
No, I don't. I do it once in a while, but I get a lot of static over it.
Yeah.
So I try to please them. But the only thing I can't stand, I have no patience. And I take a brand new guy out, and after about a half hour, I thought, why did I bring this guy? You know, throw him over the side, you'll never miss him. You know?
Yeah, right.
And Benny and Roger used to laugh and carry on work. I'd throw a shit fit in the front of the boat, and they'd be in the back saying, don't say nothing. He's all wacky with something. Yeah. But I don't do that anymore. I mellow it out.
Well, Benny told me a story of fishing with you one time, and you guys were still getting to know each other, and he kept getting bit on something, and you just said, oh, is that right, guy? And you just threw his fucking baits overboard.
Yeah, but I don't do that kind of stuff anymore.
The sound is distant? Yeah, bring the camera on up. Yeah. It's probably not clear because there's about 3 million people trying to broadcast live on the internet. You know?
I had to restart Airflex.
Yeah. Yeah, cool. But we're... Yeah, that's cool. We should be all right. As long as they can hear us and they can see us. This will be posted. This episode will still be posted next week. So there's that too.
Sound is distant.
Okay. So now, what are things like for you now these days, Jack? Are you fishing tournaments anymore? Or?
Yeah, I'm still fishing them. But the thing is, I've lost a lot of my good friends. And all of them are young bucks now. And like this guy here, you know, every time I turn around, they're kicking my ass, you know. So I have still have a good time and still enjoy it. But like now, when I go to Clemente, get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, come home, put the boat on the trailer, drive home. I don't wash the boat anymore. I just park the boat, throw my stuff in the back of the truck, take a shower, I'm gone. Mm-hmm. At noon the next day, I look out the boat thinking, I don't have to scrub it. Just hose it down real good and flush the motor. It'd be okay. Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
But like I said, I don't go that much. I try to fish every other week, but the weather lately has been horrible. So.
Yeah, we haven't been able to get out there. Local fishing's been all right, but you know, I think the adventure of getting out to the islands is really
well. We used to fish the wall at least every other week, and I knew all the guys on the wall. But now that I see guys that just wrote that article in the Western or the magazine, I'd never seen him out there. I mean, there's a lot of guys fish the wall anymore that I don't know. Never met him before.
Yeah, it's the same way for me. The calico bass angling community is growing, and there's always new faces popping up and things like that, which is. Again, why I want to reiterate, the whole purpose of this show is to try and share information and stories about guys like Jack Sowell who have been doing this, like you said, 50 or 60 years. You know, I'll be 40 in September. The guy's been doing it another lifetime beyond like what I've been doing. It's incredible for me to think about that. What were those early days of calico bass fishing? Like, what was it like? What kind of gear?
Well, Catalina was the same as the other islands are now. I mean, Catalina now is, sometimes you go over there and you're lucky to get two or three fish. Other times you go over there and it'd be a really good bite. Lately it's been really tough over there. It's been tough at Sacramento, but the weather's been the big thing. But I used to fish Santa Cruz Island a lot. I'd drive up there in the morning, come home in the afternoon. Now I come home and my daughter has a nice beach home up there. So I just drive up there, park the boat, hit the shower, eat, and I'm gone till the next morning and then come home after the traffic. But that's a thing of the past too, because I can't find anybody gets off during the week. Everybody works, you know.
Makes sense.
Yeah, it's true. Well, yeah. I'm ready to go when you are.
Okay.
You and Benny and I are going soon enough. I know that. But
I enjoy fishing with Benny. Benny is a lot of fun to fish with. And if he says he doesn't swear or talk to himself, bull. I've heard him talk a lot to them fish, you know.
Right.
Like, ooh, you son of a...
So, but the earliest days of calico bass, how did it become this prolific fishery? Was it like a half-day boat thing? Were you guys fishing sardine or anchovy? Or how did it start?
It just started, I'd go out, I had an old Stamus, 20-foot Stamus, a cuddy cabin.
Okay.
Had a bait sack. I'd buy bait, and I'd go out, and it seemed like I was catching them bigger fish on swim baits. And then when I went to Ensenada, Barry Breitenberg was down there.
Fish trap lures, you guys might not even know who that is, but Barry Breitenberg.
Barry Breitenberg gave me a bunch. He said, why don't you fish my lures? And all at once I started fishing plastic, and at that time, we was getting really bit on. And before the swim baits, I was fishing Magambos, Mojos.
Yeah, all the early stuff.
All the early stuff, we're having a good time, but it's developed into swim baits, and I haven't bought bait in the last 10, 15 years, I don't think.
Yeah.
Just all...
all artificials.
All hard baits and jigs.
Okay. And so, what about the long-range stuff? Was fishing a tradition in your family? Did your dad fish? Did you have an uncle that fished, or your grandfather?
My dad fished. I had two younger brothers, and he used to take us up in the mountains. We'd stream and river fish, and I remember one time he bought a two-piece steel fly rod.
Okay.
But it was coated with pearl, pearl colored. He was so proud of it, and he was fishing the river with a fly rod with bait. And he said, watch my rod, I go to the bathroom. When he left, we took a can of sardines, them flat cans, tore the paper off, tied it on, threw it out in the river. And then we thought, oh my God, it's going to break his rod, because his rod was just bent over, it was stuck in the bush. He come back, and he fought that can of sardines for a half mile on the river with a bunch of old guys with landing nets. And when he finally got that can of sardines in, we had to hide. We couldn't even eat dinner that night, because he was going to whip all of us. But that's the best fish story I ever had. He took us boys to the mountains, and we almost killed him, because we'd cook, and he'd say, what is this? Oh, it's hunter stew. We made it.
So whatever you found, he just...
Oh, yeah, we just put it in the pot,
So that's where it started?
That's where it started with my dad.
With your dad.
Then I come down here and started fishing long range, and I fished long range for a long time. Then I got into bass one time on a trip. It was, I think, a 15-day, 14-day. It got really bad, so we had to go into, what's the big bay down there?
Mag Bay.
Had to go into Mag Bay, way inside and anchored, and the calico and the sand bass bite was phenomenal.
Every bait that hit the water, huh?
Oh, yeah, it was, I thought. And I had taken a bunch of Mojos and Magambos and Scampis with me, and that's all I fished. And when I come back, I just kept on fishing them, But I haven't fished tuna now in about 3 years. The last trip I made, I had three over 100, and the third day they were getting big fish, and I said, I've had all the big fish I want to pull on. You can go right ahead.
So you said you have three over 300?
Two over 300.
What boat do you typically fish, or what's the boat that you
typically fish? I used to fish the old Qualifier, but I fished with Sam Petula when Sam was a skipper on the with deckhand. Then he became a skipper. Then he bought a boat from Long Beach, that big, tall, skinny thing. And then he bought the American Angler, him and Brian.
Oh, yeah.
And I've been fishing with Brian and Sam for a long time.
On the American Angler. A good friend of mine, Travis Potter, he ran deck or worked deck on the American Angler for a while. But
I've met Travis.
Yeah. He's an awesome guy. Yeah. So he works with me on bongos. Incredible human being. So the long range thing, you said you got a Wahoo over 100 pounds.
I think it was 112.
Where is that, at Alejos or Clonet?
I don't remember, but he was the fastest ship. I mean, I had a bait out, a big salami for a big tuna. He was going out, and I said, I'm bit. And I just cranked it and gave it one jerk. And they come straight back to the boat, hit the side of the boat, and who's the kid that had the bad lip?
Cal.
Cal gaffed him. I thought it was an alligator coming over. And he just kept coming. I thought, holy Jesus, look at the size of that thing.
Awesome.
And I won the jackpot over the tuna with that damn
with a Wahoo. 100
pounder?
112.
112. That was in San Diego.
112 pound Wahoo.
So
that in perspective.
With all these big fish like your tuna and your like Wahoo, why are you so attracted to calicos? Like, why do you keep going to a fish that's, the world record is what, 15 something or
14?
No.
Yeah, right.
I keep waiting to get a 15, and I think I've had a couple 15s on.
Yeah.
And I was at Catalina up by the isthmus and had a monster calico, and when he came alongside like a dumb idiot, I couldn't believe it. I just looked at him. And he was just there, and he just shook his head and the plastic fell off. He looked at me and
see ya.
I thought, dumbass. What are you doing?
How many double digit calico bass do you have?
I know I had three over 11 because we had scales, but I don't weigh them anymore. I've caught two this last year in a Catalina that I think were good 10, solid 10.
So I believe it. People tend to think that San Clemente Island's the place of real big fish, but to every giant fish I've ever heard of is Catalina or Santa Cruz.
Catalina's got some really big fish. I've never caught, my biggest fish at Santa Cruz Island is like 6 or 7 pounds.
Okay.
And we won a lot of tournaments up there, a lot of big fish things with 6 pounders.
Yeah.
In fact, fishing San Diego last year, I fished two trips down there where it was go anywhere you want. I fished San Diego along the, below the landing there.
Okay. Like Point Loma area?
Yeah. And I've got two over 6 and both of them are jackpot fish.
Awesome.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. So you've got 3 over 11 and you've had some bigger fish hooked.
Well, I don't know. They were over 10. You know, 10, yeah. 11 on a boat, you can't really tell. But
yeah.
Anymore, they're just
big fish.
I just turned the big fish loose, you know.
Right.
I don't care. I've had all the big fish I need. I'm looking for the 3-pound eaters.
And yeah.
People say they don't eat calicos or nuts.
Yeah.
They're good.
And you know, we're kind of managing the fishery ourselves, calling out the like slot limit. You know, like you said, the 3-pounders kind of 14 to 17 inches, it's a good fish to keep.
They're good 15-inch fish. It makes two nice fillets.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've fished with you before where we brought home limits, and I never have a problem eating calico bass.
My daughter was not a fish eater, and she came over one time, and I was cutting the calicos in strips and dipping them and deep frying them. And when I got all done, there was no fish.
So Benny's on there saying he held one of your fish that was 11 pounds.
He could have, I don't know. But you gotta watch Benny. He fudges a little bit once in a while.
You heard that, Benny. That's awesome that Benny's watching.
Yeah.
So you turned your daughter into a fish eater with a calico bass.
Yeah, she likes fish now. In fact, when they come over, first thing I do is lock the garage or go out and check the garage because I have 6 packs of fillets. All of us only have 2 left.
Right. They're just they're taking what they want from you.
So they take the calicos.
Do any of your daughters, did they grow up fishing with you, or son-in-laws or anybody, or is there any other family members that fish calico bass?
No, I took my wife, both daughters, and the dog to Huntington Flats and kept them out there till all three of them were down and puking and brought them in, and they've never asked to go back, and I've never had to worry about it.
Good call.
Right? And yeah. So it's your own thing. It's your own ritual.
And I took my granddaughter out. When she's like 25, 26, with 2 other girls, we're at Huntington Flats fishing sand bass, and they decided to disrobe and they got bikinis on. I had no boats around me. All at once, I couldn't cast for the boats just surrounding me. I said, girls, put your tops on. First thing they did was, God damn it, you know, get your clothes on. And then all at once, they started turning white, and my granddaughter said, Grandpa, I don't feel real good. So when you come in the channel and make the turn in front of the restaurant, what's the restaurant there?
Which landing?
At Long Beach.
South Shore?
Yeah.
Parker's Lighthouse?
Well, one of them. When I turned in there, they were all, well, let's stop and eat. So it cost me about $80 to make that.
Oh, because you had to feed all of them.
I had to feed them all. You know, they got well in a hurry and ate. And
that was that.
That was that. But no one in the family fishes except my son-in-law fishes and my grandson fishes. I take him out. He doesn't get to go that often, but when I've taken him to Santa Cruz a lot.
Cool.
And he's a good kid.
What's your affinity? How did Santa Cruz become a big part of your fishery? Because it's a bit of a drive for you. It's like a 2-hour drive with a boat behind the truck. How did Santa Cruz?
It only takes me 1 hour 15 minutes. No, it. We started fishing Santa Cruz from Santa Monica Bay.
Okay.
And we had a couple tournaments, go anywhere you want.
So you ran 60 miles up that way.
Run up that way. And we were going to Deep Hole. Deep Hole didn't work, so we run to the island. And then from then on, I just started driving up there.
Yeah.
And then my daughter got the house up there on the beach, so nice place to go. But we've gone from Long Beach a lot. No, that's Santa Barbara.
Yeah. Santa Barbara Island, I mean, that's, to me, that's always been Jack's Island. Benny always, you know, said, this is Jack's Island. Jack brought me here. Jack's caught big fish here. You know, you've obviously have a bit of history with that island, and we don't need to go down that road. But what is it about that place?
I took, who's the tall guy with the hair, wild hair? The big boat.
Jimmy.
Jimmy Decker.
Yeah, it was me, you, and him.
Oh, yeah. The three of us.
It was the three of us.
And I drove the boat, and Decker was in the front catching calicos, and just throwing him in the boat. Get him! I got another one! He absolutely freaked out over there. Mm-hmm. And we did have a wild bite.
Oh, we had a wild, wild bite.
And night. I just told him at 2 o'clock, I said, we're going home. We're lying to me.
Jerk Shad Island, right?
Jerk Shad Island, yeah. We did the Settle Island, the little island there. And Jack was driving the boat, like he said, there was a moment. Jack told you he doesn't push it as hard as he used to. There was a moment when I looked over the bow and thought, I hope this guy puts it in reverse right now.
I remember that.
You remember that?
We made it. I went too far up before I made the turn and run right up where the brakes over the rocks. I just looked over and back down, and Decker goes, boat usually dies when you put it in reverse that fast. I said, well, they're looking out for us.
Yeah, it was definitely one of those moments where it's like, all right, Jack knows what the fuck he's doing. Definitely good mojo on the boat. But we got into phenomenal fishing on that trip. There's actually a video on my YouTube channel, Fishing with Decker, but it's myself, Jimmy Decker, and Jack, and you know, that place is a special place. But how'd you end up going there? Is this another fucking destination, huh?
Yeah, that's where I met my Waterloo, almost, and I was banned from the island for a long time. I didn't go up there. And then I went back, and I avoid that one area of the island. I just don't go in there.
Yep, understandable.
But other than that, you know, it isn't very comfortable sleeping on the rocks.
No. But it's a fantastic fishery.
Oh, yeah.
What is it about those bass there that make them so fucking strong?
Well, they're short and fat. I never caught a really long fish there, but they're all nice and fat and just real aggressive. When the bite's on there, it's just really on. I really like the island, but I don't go there that often anymore.
Yeah, I feel blessed to have been there with you. I've been there with you a couple times. I've been there with John, your friend John. We fished there before and had fun there. And then, you know, like you said, you and Jimmy and I have been there. But so do you notice anything about specific islands and the way their fish are? What's up?
There's a question right now. Does Jack ever fish San Nick?
Have you ever fished San Nicolas Island? Somebody watching right now wants to know.
I went there one time, and we were there maybe 10 minutes, and it was so bad, I thought, if we can just get back to Sacramento, I'll never go beyond Sacramento. I've been there on a sport boat one time, fishing, what's some other fish they fish for?
Sheephead or yellowtail?
No, they're like bass, only they're not.
Oh, the Johnny bass or the cods? The Johnny bass. Oh, Johnny bass.
We were catching Johnny bass, and I fished for a little bit and just give it up, but I'd never been out there that much, maybe twice. And when you got Sacramento and the other islands, why bother to go that far?
That's true.
If you could only fish one island, which one would it be?
Santa Cruz.
Yeah, your favorite for the eight?
Yeah. But yet, last year we fished that one tournament up there, and I fished that new partner, what's his name?
Who was he fishing with?
The ball-headed guy?
Oh, Dave Ullery.
Dave
Ullery, yeah.
And Dave,
he's a rowdy son of a bitch.
Oh, he was so terrified that day.
You know, what'd you do to him?
It was really, really bad. And he kept saying, shouldn't we run sideways? I said, you run sideways, you're going to be dead meat. We got to just go downhill. But we were fishing, and he'd say, here comes another one. I said, it's okay. But we started back. We had a following sea, and I'd be up on top, and I'd just charge down the front, and we'd bury the bow. And the guy, I think he'd come home and got rid of all of his gear and didn't fish in the ocean for a long time. And so he give up. He fished with me a couple of years ago down in San Diego, but I don't get to fish with Dave that much. He's got a boat of his own now.
Yeah, he's a good guy. Dave, we love you if you're watching. That's a good story, though. So yeah, so if you could fish any island, it'd be Santa Cruz, huh?
Yeah.
Is it just the way that it fishes, or just something about it, or is it because it's the convenience with the house up there, and it just makes it easy?
It's,
to
if the weather's bad, the backside of the island is just always nice. But then coming home, you're always going downhill, so yeah. It makes it nice.
Yeah, that's true. But and it's not as much of a run. It's only like, what, we have 15 minutes? Perfect. But it's, yeah, it's not as far of a run. It's like 16 no. miles to the east end of the island from Channel Islands Harbor, right?
Yeah, it ain't bad at all. And I fished deep hole. I used to fish deep hole quite a bit.
And for people watching, that is up towards Point Doom.
Yeah, yeah. Right? And we've had some good bites up there. But it seems like when you go to deep hole, you get a lot of the sport boats from Santa Monica and Ventura coming down that way. So
yeah.
You got jigs flying all around you if you get too close to them.
That's a good point. Have you noticed over the last, let's just shorten it up, over the last 2 decades, the fishery change, or does it seem like it's as healthy as it's always been, or does it seem like the fish are smaller, or have they just moved areas because of pressure and they're smart enough to kind of move away from that, or?
Well, right now, I think there's more guys fishing calico bass than there's ever been.
I agree.
You go to the island now, you'll see a half dozen boats over there within a couple miles of it.
Who?
Kenny wants to know if you caught a 10-pounder at Santa Cruz.
Any 10-pounders at Santa Cruz?
Yeah, I've never caught a 10-pounder at Santa Cruz, I don't think. I can't remember ever catching one. I've caught a couple of seals that go 200-300 pounds.
How do you get the name Rockhopper?
I got that name in Mexico. I was fishing, and all at once, it went down, and I was sitting right on a rock, and a trolling motor was just buzzing.
So swell would drop down.
And I thought, what the heck? And then the swell come up, and I just motored right off it. And that's how I got the name Rockhopper, and it just stuck with me.
That's as good as it gets. So,
yeah.
So back just because we jumped off the subject a little bit, back to the fishery, you think for sure there's way more guys fishing calico bass now than there ever was.
Oh, yeah. And not only are there more guys fishing, there's more guys throwing plastic and artificials. Mm. And more guys with trolling motors. You didn't used to see 15, 20 years ago, I'd see maybe one boat. Now you see 24 footers with trolling motors on the front, running 50 miles an hour. They pass me like I'm parked.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of guys that are serious bass fishing anymore. But I'll say this, 90% of them turned all the fish loose.
Yeah.
There aren't a lot of guys selling calicos. No, yeah. I have nothing against guys that take 5 calicos. I've never taken 10.
Yeah,
I have on occasion, but
you don't do it often.
No, usually 5. In fact, I've come home with 2 fish, two 6-pounders. That's a couple of nice meals, and so I just don't keep them that much. And but yeah, I see a lot of difference. A lot of guys fishing anymore. In fact, even at Sacramento, it used to be you go over there and you wouldn't see anybody. Now you see 2 or 3 guys.
Yep, and so I agree with you on that, and. I think that the savvy tournament anglers and the savvy bass guys, because information is so readily available, I mean, you had to show yourself what to do. You figured it all out. Guys maybe handed you this and said, hey, why don't you do this? But now the learning curve is cut to 0. It's like, do this, throw this, go here, do that. That's how you do it. And I think that approach has really affected the fishery,
It has somewhat, but the only thing I really get burned up at is snob fishermen.
Oh yeah.
When I pull up on the ramp and I get new guys coming up, how'd you do? Oh, we had a really good day. And I try to show them over. And of course, I'm working for Fish Trap, and I try to show them the swim baits. And I usually give 2 or 3 of them away. But anything I hate to snob on the ramp where yeah, I caught fish. You dumbass. You guys fishing? I don't want to talk to you. I know some guys like that, and they just fell by the wayside. And but there's a lot of nice guys out there anymore, and to meet them. Is when you go to them tournaments. And I've never had, I think I met one guy I didn't like real well, and he's since become a nice guy.
Awesome. And that's awesome.
After we knocked him down and kicked him a few times,
made him earn it.
Yeah.
That's a good thing to bring up because, I know you don't see this shit, but on social media, there's been a lot of hodgepodge, boiling hot water over, this, that, and the other, this tournament series, that tournament series, but I agree with you. If you just kind of ignore the politics, or you just kind of steer clear of the guys that are, naysayers or kind of negative, there's some really incredible people that fish these tournaments, and they're all, to me, they're all just really incredible guys.
There are, but it's been about 5 or 6 years ago, I was fishing at Catalina Inner Tournament. And I went down below in that closed area. I didn't know it was closed. I was in there. And these guys come by, and rather than catch, they come in and say, hey, you're in a closed area, I'd have left right then.
Yeah.
If I had fish in there, I'd have thrown them away. But they took my picture in there and then turned it in and said, don't tell who it is. Well, I found out who it was, and I let them know how what I thought of it. I said, I could have lost my boat. I could have got a hell of a ticket. I could have lost all my gear because you're too much of a snob to come in and tell me.
Yeah.
But they've since been thrown out of the SWBA and the SWB and everything else. They're total asses.
Yeah. They got
that's two. Hearts getting thrown out to you right now, Jack.
Lots of hearts means a lot of people are liking it. They push this little button and it fucking makes these hearts fly up and it means they're stoked. It means they're happy.
Good.
Yeah.
A lot of thank yous, a lot of hearts.
Yeah.
Well, there's a lot of neat guys out there, and you meet a lot of them on the ramp, and I see a lot of them over there, you know. And what gets me is I've gone to different places, especially up north. I'll be up there, and I'll launch my boat, and here comes two or three guys, hey, Jack. And I'm thinking, boy, I had a stroke, but I don't remember meeting any guys at all. And they say, no, you never met me, but I fished with so-and-so, and he knew you, and blah, blah, blah. And they just treat me like old friends, so... There's a lot of neat guys out there, and this guy, I run into him once in a while, you know. He's usually falling down stupid drunk.
Yeah, that was definitely, there's been those times,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, once or twice.
Yeah.
Didn't we fish at night a couple of times on the wall?
Tristan has this question here. It says, what is Jack's most favorite thing about caliber bass fishing?
So that's him. What's your favorite thing about caliber bass fishing?
You're busy all the time. You aren't standing there drowning worms forever. Hey, you know, everybody to the right, everybody move to the right, wind an angle, put another bait on. You're busy all the time. You're casting constantly. And this last trip, I went maybe 2 weeks, and I cast all day long. It was a slow day. Next day, I thought, what's wrong with my shoulders? Everything's falling apart on me. But, yeah. Calico bass fishing, you're going to stay in shape, especially if you're in a 20-foot or smaller boat, even a 24. When you go to Sacramento and you got a two-hour ride coming home, a two-hour ride going over, and I take guys over, and coming home I see them, they got a grip on the tower, and they leave their fingerprints in it. And they're so sore the next day they can't move from the muscle tension.
Absolutely.
Then I take other guys over, and they're loose as a goose, you know. And I got a pee, I just stop the boat and they go, hey, what are you doing? They're laying on your ass. So there's a lot of things we have a good time out there with.
Yeah, that's true. I've been the subject of Jack's humor one time, you know, coming home from San Clemente Island. He's driving the boat, but then once we come inside the channel of Catalina, when that prevailing, you know, west-southwest swell comes, he'll say, hey, guy. Drive the boat for a little bit, and he'll go over to the starboard side and be high and dry, and you know the guy driving the boat wears it home. But you know what? That to me, it's just been an honor to get to know you and spend time with you on the water. And
I took a friend out, and we're coming home, and he's over there high and dry, and he said, "You're all wet." Yeah, blah, blah, blah. And slowly I turned upstream. You know, he didn't notice where it was overcast. You know, how much he just. Dude, you're getting drowned. Boy, the ocean's really getting bad. Yeah, and then I finally turned wind in the channel, but I got even with it.
I was lucky enough to fish with him once with Craig Bark, and I was in the back of the boat, you know, just being quiet the first time getting to fish with him. And I'm sitting there not catching anything, and he's catching like fish left and right, and starts throwing bass at me in the back of the boat. And I'm just like, so these what bass look like? And he's just like throwing them at me. I'm like, that's so messed up.
I went out with, he was on a boat, I remember whose boat was on, but he was throwing iron. And he got all the big fish, you know. We were all catching fish. He was going right through the kelp. Oh, another lunker. I thought, oh, shit, I'll throw his ass when he's out of here.
You got a question?
First of all, before you go any further, what time is it?
Oh, yeah.
54.
Okay, so we have 6 minutes.
One more question.
Okay, yeah.
Or a few questions.
Yeah.
What's your experience been catching calico bass in Mexico?
I've caught a lot of big fish down here. Not big, I'd say 5, maybe a 6-pounder. And we won that Ensenada Rodeo maybe 3 times out of 10 years. And a guy named Rich Marcel.
I remember him.
That guy beat me by 6 ounces, you know, just always borderline. And the 1 year, he dropped a big fish on the deck and it went over the side of the pier and he lost and I won it. And he was crying and boo-hoo, and I told him, you know, yeah, I really feel bad for you. But no, Ensenada, we had a good time down there. Used to fish down there a lot. Now I won't go to Mexico driving.
Yeah, that's a pretty rowdy situation.
I got two tickets going down and two tickets coming back.
Oh, what's going on?
A lot of stoked people on this episode.
Rad. Yeah, I mean, frick, we're all
shock is in love. Obviously.
We're very blessed to be in your presence, Jack. And I think our time's winding down, but before we go and before we think of anything else, I just want to make sure you know, man, you've given this, if you want to call it a sport, you've given this sport, but you've given our way of life so much. And you don't even try. You're just a good guy. You always share information. You're telling people how you're getting bit. You like you said, you're not the guy that's at the dock being a snob. And, you know, you're really friendly. All you got to do is come up and say hi. And you treat everyone fairly, man. And it goes a long way. And I hope people take a lot away from this episode, knowing that guys like this that are pioneers for what we're doing, you better pay respect and take a little something from it and pay it forward, because we all need each other and we got to be cool.
And anymore, I carry a gun. Remember that. Yeah. If you harass me on the ramp, I've got a gun.
Yeah. Don't fuck with Jack at the dock.
I've got a great grandson that's 4.
Okay.
And he'll be fishing with me in a couple of years. I hope.
Yeah.
The grandpa's still around. No, you fall over the side and drown.
No, you will be.
And it's getting pretty touchy, you know.
What's his name?
Jason.
I've actually heard, you've told me stories about him.
I got two Jasons. His dad's Jason and he's a Jason.
What's going on over there?
It's a lot of French.
Oh, okay.
All of a sudden.
Yeah, all right. Well, yeah.
Well, on Radio Sounds, fishing, somebody's asking, what's your rod, reel, and setup when you started fishing calico bass? We have 2 minutes.
Okay. What was your setup when you first started fishing calico bass? I would say with artificials.
Root beer scampies.
Yeah.
Root beer mojos. And Magambos. Them three with the plastic. And also key lime green was good for sand bass.
Yep. What about the rod and the reel?
I used to fish the old Abu silver ones.
Oh, the ambassadors.
The ambassadors. It would, the anti-reverse thing would fall out. You'd wind backwards either way.
You find them in reverse.
Yeah.
We're saying bye. Okay, so hey, for all you guys out there that watched.
Adios, amigo.
There you go.
Stay dry.
20 seconds.
That's how you do it right there. You stay dry. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you guys in 2 weeks. This episode will be posted next Thursday on the Radio Silence Fishing Facebook page.
Yay.
Good night, you guys. Thanks a lot.
Well, you sat late. 10 seconds.
Special thanks. That's what we got.
Who's kitty cat?
That's all right.
It's these guys.
He lives here.
Huh?
He lives here.
Little Bengal. He's cool, huh? He's pretty exotic.
Bradshaw, thank you.
Peace out.
All right, thank you guys.
Jack. Hey, that was fun.
That was fun, huh?
That was awesome, Jack.
Basically, lovely.
Is this your cat?
Yeah.
Wow, he's a half mountain lion.
Did he make it all the way through?
Yeah,
he did.
He's actually a third Chinese leopard.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so Chinese leopards are like small cats that love water. So basically, a cougar. Well, they're
super
leopard, and they're very vocal.
Awesome.
They love the water. So,
they're
called Bengals.
He likes my coat, too.
Do you mind coming to take him off?
Yeah, I know.
He's very lovely.
But when I get home, my dog will go nuts.
I'm sure. Look at his nails. He's like loving it.
Good to see you.
Thanks for coming over here.
Let's.
Yes.
No, it went perfect. Let's feed Jack. Let's all eat. And when I
picked out before I come.
Oh, did you?
How you doing, bud?
Before when I spoke to Shirley, I said, she said, what time should he be there by? And I said, if he's there by 8:15, it'll be all right. And then she said, 8:15. I said, well, we won't have him out too late, I promise. So.
Thanks so much for coming, Jack.
Oh, no problem. I enjoyed it.
Want some fun.
Please have a taco, eat some chips.
I'm gonna have a shrimp.
Huh?
Yeah, have a shrimp.
What's up, Jack? Good to see you, sir.
Hey, guy.
Boom.
How you been?
You did good.
Well,
awesome.
I've been running into you a lot lately.
I know. I've been lurking in
town. What up, Jacob?
How are you? Good to see you, sir. Too bad.
Dude.
I wish to stop fishing right now. It's so windy and cold.
It's freezing.
It is freezing out there.
Freezing balls. Freezing balls.
You know that? So.
Yeah.
You remember how to push the button? Oh, man. Cool, that went well.
That was awesome.
I like it.
Can I wash my hands upstairs in your sink?
Yeah. What's the statistic, Justin?
394 viewers on my phone.
He's like, oh, I'm sleeping.
Kyle had over 250 on the bear flag one. Okay. And then he had to restart it, and when he restarted, there was another 300.